This is Haiti, the poorest nation in the entire Western Hemisphere. Just 600 miles away are the shores of Miami, Florida, where you might expect to earn over $35,000 each year. Compare that to Haiti, where the yearly per capita income is only around $1,500. How could it be that the US became one of the richest countries in the world, whilst Haiti became one of the poorest? One reason comes down to what economists call institutions and their effects on economic growth. Institutions are the sets of laws or structures which control how people are allowed to act. They are like the rules of the game. And just as you can have fair and unfair rules, you can have inclusive and extractive institutions. Think of things like a dependable legal system, a democratic and honest government, and strong property rights, all examples of good, inclusive institutions. Whilst a weak rule of law, corrupt government officials, and weak property rights are extractive institutions. The economists Acemoglu, Johnson, and Robinson started to question how bad institutions might affect a nation's growth.
The real difference between a place like Haiti and the US is they have very different institutions, very different rules, that give very different patterns of incentives and opportunities for people. So you get investment and saving and entrepreneurship and technological development in the United States. But in Haiti, the incentives are just terrible to do something like that.
And so they formed a hypothesis, predicting that nations with more inclusive institutions would be richer and more economically developed today. But when it came to testing this theory, they faced a big problem. To illustrate this, let's look again at the US and Haiti. In Haiti, the quality of institutions are relatively bad, whilst the US has better institutions. And we know that Haiti is a much poorer nation than the US. What we don't know, however, is which came first. It might be that the good institutions made the US richer, but it's also possible that richer nations like the US can afford to invest in better institutions because they are rich. After all, it might be easier to root out problems like corruption if you have lots of money to fund a good police force. To solve this problem, the economists set about finding the underlying reason for a country's institutions, to make sure good institutions were not just chosen by rich countries. And they found just this in the decisions of Western colonizers. See, Western colonizers historically set up different forms of institutions in different areas across the world. In areas with many diseases which plagued white Western people, colonizers were unable to settle and live there, facing high mortality rates. This didn't mean, however, that colonizers simply left these areas. Far from it. Instead, they set up bad, extractive institutions, which funneled the resources and wealth of these nations back to Europe.
Places today, former colonies today, which have much worse institutions, had much higher rates of mortality for Europeans historically. And that's because they were just very unattractive places to settle. So then if you can't settle, there's much more incentive to behave in a very predatory and extractive way.
But in more hospitable areas with less disease, the story was far different. Take Australia, for example, which presented a much lower risk to mortality than Africa. By the 1800s, large numbers of Europeans had settled there, both ex-jailers and ex-convicts sent from Britain. Along with the settlers, however, came their demands that life in Australia should be like in Britain. They argued that they were still British, and so deserved the same rights and institutions as offered at home. The British government agreed, allowing good, inclusive institutions such as democratic representation and property rights. Across many nations, a similar pattern occurred. Where Europeans could settle, good institutions were allowed to develop, and where they could not, bad, extractive institutions were set up, which worked to simply exploit and extract resources to make Europe richer. And it's this fact which is vital in answering our original hypothesis. See, now, instead of using the quality of institutions, we can use settler mortality, since this somewhat determines the institutional quality itself. If our original hypothesis is correct, then areas with low settler mortality, where Europeans were able to settle, will be richer and more economically developed today. This chart starts to explain what the three economists found. Along the x-axis is settler mortality. The further to the right, the lower the chance that Europeans settled and the worse the quality of institutions as a result. Along the y-axis is the log GDP per capita in 1995, essentially how wealthy and economically developed these nations are today. Add in the countries and we can start to see a trend. Let's look at Australia. As we know, The low settler mortality meant Europeans moved here and were allowed to set up good, inclusive institutions. And, as a result, today Australia is relatively well off. To see the other side of the story, we only have to look further to the right, for example, Nigeria. Here, settler mortality was much higher, which meant the British largely set up bad, extractive institutions. And, as we expect, today, Nigeria is far poorer because of this. And so, as we might have expected, institutions do appear to have an effect on the wealth and economic development of nations today. Colonial regions where Europeans were unable to settle had extractive institutions forced upon them, which stifled market competition and concentrated power in the hands of a few elites. Whilst nowadays, most of these nations no longer see their resources funneled to Europe, these extractive institutions have persisted. And it's these institutions which continue to hold back developing nations today. Thank you to James Robinson for his support as part of this project. Please watch further videos in our series delivered by Discover Economics and Cage Research Centre. Please visit our website and follow us on social media.